All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and that the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lonely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent and praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. The third scripture reading is from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 29 through 31. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on the wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. If you would please turn to page 315 in your journal, we'll be singing the Solid Rock, and we'll sing all four verses.
Thank you. Thank you. Next to that. Down. How about that? Okay. Thank you, graduates, for inviting me here to speak to you at this important time in each of your lives. I commend you for coming voluntarily to this baccalaureate service, which links your religious faith to your academic accomplishments. Unfortunately, our legal system has concluded that separation of church and state means that God must be excluded from our public schools. But your presence here today shows that you have succeeded in keeping God in your life, including your public school education. I want to talk to you today about your private lives. Each of your lives are about to change radically. Some of you will go into the world of work, some of you to further your education, some to the military. Whatever may be your next step in this journey of your life, you will be tested. Your thoughts, your values, your worldview, your faith will be tested. Each of you is a Christian, so I want to ask the question, what does the Christian life look like? What should be the characteristics of our life if we are to be Christians? I want to answer that question, what should the Christian life look like, by looking at an Old Testament character. So I'm going to turn to the book of Daniel. And if Mason would help me, I have here copies of the scripture I'm going to read so each of you can follow along with you. And there are Bibles in the pews, I think, if anybody would like to follow along. This is the first chapter of Daniel. And I'm going to read it. So Mason's scripture reading wasn't as long as this. So just sit back and listen, because this is a great story. It's a great story. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. Now, just to stop here for a minute, the third year of King Jehoiakim of Judah was 605 B.C. So it was 2,624 years ago. And yet it has something to tell us today. I said B.C. because I don't buy into the B.C.E. and C.E. designations, because they take Christ out of dating and calendar, but I'm not going to do that. Verse 2, and the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with some of the vessels of the house of God. And he brought them to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God, and placed the vessels in the treasury of his God. Then the king commanded Ashpenaz, his chief eunuch, to bring some of the people of Israel, both of the royal family and of the nobility, youths without blemish, they would have been about your age, of good appearance, as you all are, skillful in all wisdom, endowed with knowledge, understanding learning, and competent to stand in the king's palace. Competent to stand in the king's palace probably means they're good communicators. They could stand before the king and tell him of their learning and answer his questions. And to teach them the literature and language of the Chaldeans, which is to say the Babylonians. The king assigned them a daily portion of the food that the king ate and of the wine that he drank. They were to be educated for 3 years, and at the end of that time, they were to stand before the king. Among these were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah of the tribe of Judah. And the chief of the eunuchs gave them names. Daniel he called Belteshazzar. Hananiah he called Shadrach. Mishael he called Meshach. And Azariah he called Abednego. But Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself with the king's food or with the wine that he drank. Therefore he asked the chief of the eunuchs to allow him not to defile himself. And God gave Daniel favor and compassion in the sight of the chief of the eunuchs. And the chief of the eunuchs said to Daniel, I fear my lord the king who assigned your food and your drink, for why should he see that you are in worse condition than the youths who are of your own age? So you would endanger my head with Then Daniel said to the steward whom the chief of the eunuchs had assigned over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, test your servants for 10 days. Let us be given vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then let our appearance and the appearance of the youths who eat the king's food be observed by you, and deal with your servants according to what you see. So he listened to them in this matter and tested them for 10 days. At the end of 10 days, it was seen that they were better in appearance and fatter in flesh than all the youths who ate the king's food. So the steward took away their food and the wine they were to drink and gave them vegetables. As for these four youths, God gave them learning and skill in all literature and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. At the end of the time when the king had commanded that they should be brought in, the chief of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar. And the king spoke with them, and among all of them, none was found like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore they stood before the king. And in every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters that were in his kingdom. And Daniel was there until the first year of King Cyrus. There's a lot going on here. But let's look at a few things here. There's so much here we could never do it while we're here today. But let's look at a few things. Look back in verse 1 and 2. What's going on? King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon defeats Judah and its king Jehoiakim. But who is in control? Look at verse 2. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand. Look at verse 9. And God gave Daniel favor and compassion in the sight of the chief of the eunuchs. And look at verse 17. As for these four youths, God gave them learning and skill in all literature and so on. So who's in control here? God's in control here. And the first part of the answer to our question, what does the Christian life look like, is he or she who is living the Christian life knows that God is in control and thinks, speaks, and acts accordingly, even in the most private parts of their lives. Look at verse 3. Nebuchadnezzar orders his chief eunuch, which was a high court official, to bring back to Babylon from conquered Judah certain Jews having certain characteristics. And the characteristics he wanted are set forth in verses 3 and 4. From royal or noble families, so the higher echelon of society, youth, which would have been probably about your age, without blemish of good appearance, skillful in wisdom, endowed with knowledge, and competent to stand before the king. And the chief eunuch was to do something to these young people from Judah that they were bringing back to Babylon. They were going to change their language, teach them the language of the Babylonians. They were going to change their literature, teach them the literature of the Babylonians. They were going to change their diet and have them eat the food from the king's table, drink wine from the king's table. They were going to change their names, given the names here that were changed. This is a 7th century BC version of brainwashing, of mind control or indoctrination. King Nebuchadnezzar was going to rip from these young Jewish people their Jewishness and make them essentially Babylonians. He was removing their Jewish names, their language, their literature. What's literature? Literature are the stories with which we define ourselves. Language is the way in which we express the deepest thoughts of our being. Our name defines who we are, and replacing them with Babylonian counterparts. In so doing, he would also separate them from God. You will face similar, if more subtle, attempts to change who you are. I hope you will not be taken away to a foreign land as a captive. I don't think that's going to happen to you. But Scripture says in 1 Peter 2:11, we are sojourners and exiles. We are like foreigners in this world because we're Christians. It also says at the end of that same verse that the passions of our flesh wage war against our soul. So we are like foreigners in a war zone. That's what the Bible tells us. And I want to tell you right now, co-workers, bosses, college professors, those with whom or under whom you serve in the military service, will include people who will ridicule you for your Christianity. They will seek to diminish your relationship with God, and they will try to change who you are as a Christian, just as Nebuchadnezzar did these young Jews. But let's look at what Daniel did in response. Look at verse 8. But Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself with the king's food or with the wine that he drank. Daniel resolved. A resolution or a resolve is an act of the mind or of the will. We would say Daniel firmly decided not to defile himself. An act of the mind or of the will is often stated by one of these two important words: yes or no. In the next few months and years, the word no may be very important to you. It draws a line of resistance. It says, here I stand on the word of God, and I will not cross that line. Look at how Daniel drew his line of resistance. It says in the second part of verse 8, therefore he asked the chief of the eunuchs to allow him not to defile himself. He took his stand, expressed his decision respectfully, and relied upon God. So the second part of our answer to the question, what does the Christian life look like, is he or she who is living the Christian life draws a line of resistance against anything that would separate him from God. Now let's look at verse 9. What's it say? It says, God gave Daniel favor. Daniel took his stand, drew the line, and God gave him success. And verse 17 says something similar. As for these four youths, God gave them learning and skill in all literature. So we have the third part of our answer. And one of the young ladies read it in verse 31 of Isaiah 40. The third part of our answer is, he or she who is living the Christian life waits upon the Lord. Waits upon the Lord. And as she read so nicely, they who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount with wings like eagles. So the answer to our question, what does the Christian life look like, is the Christian thinks, speaks, and acts knowing that God is in control. The Christian draws a line of resistance against those who would separate him or her from God. And the Christian waits upon the Lord. You can find no better guide for your life every day in times of transition like you are in now, or in times of calm, than your Bible. Keep it close. Read it often. And you can find no better friend than Jesus. Pray to him often. And know that God is control, is in control. Draw your line of resistance and wait upon the Lord.
You're all going to hear me, but I'm going to talk to you, okay? Something very simple, just a prayer. That's all we're going to do between you and I. I want to thank you, like the others have thanked you before me, for professing your participation in the kingdom of God, being a Christian. And like many have said, you're going to be tested many, many times. Stand fast. Don't let the ground shake in front of you. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you with thankful hearts for all those near and dear to us who are graduating from high school. We thank you for giving each graduate the talents, the abilities, and the self-discipline required for this wonderful accomplishment. We are grateful to you for providing the teachers, mentors, coaches, and youth counselors who have taught them, nurtured them, and challenged them along the way. Now that their minds have been well equipped with the basic knowledge of many different subjects, we pray that their hearts and spirits will also be well equipped for successful living. Add heavenly wisdom and discernment to their knowledge. Infuse the ambitions and dreams with your love. Help them to desire your good way for their future. Remind them that you are only a prayer away when they meet obstacles, heartbreaks, and challenges. May they always be courageous enough to ask for help, advice, and support when they need it. May they never needlessly suffer alone without reaching out to you and to others who care. As they become independent adults, help them learn the secrets of dependence on you. Give them a desire to know more about you. May they find you in the scriptures, in the joy of new love, in the gathering of your people, in the beauty of your creation, and in the strength of their youth. And now may your blessings be theirs as they begin a new life full of joy and promise. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Against the forces the rulers, authorities, against the cosmic power over this present darkness, against spiritual forces, evil, in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil days, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes on your feet, having put on the readiness to be given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. You will be going into a world that can be dark. You need not fear. You put on the armor of God. I'd like to pray with me now. Father, every parent in this room is releasing the hand of their child to some extent. From the time they were barely able to walk, they held our hand, and we guided them. We protected them. And we think they gave them strength and learning and knowledge. And now that time is so far past is upon us. And somehow those small children have become adult men and women. And we no longer will be holding their hand. We no longer will be able to protect them as we think we did. But Lord, we take confidence in knowing that they were only ours for a while. They have always been your children. You brought them into this world. You have cared for them. You have strengthened them. And Lord, we have confidence that you will strengthen them from here on in their lives. Father, we pray that at any time they are concerned, at any time they feel like they've been set by forces against them, that perhaps this coin and these phrases, the scripture, will help them remember that they have nothing for fear because you have given them the whole armor of God. Bless them, Lord, and bless the parents who in a week or so are going to be almost too far gone to appreciate the children are leaving them. But it's a joyous thing. It is a joyous thing, Lord. We bless them. We ask you to bless them in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you.
church prevails. We have Christ on promise, and that cannot fail. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war. With the cross of Jesus going on before. Onward, then, be people. Join our happy throng, lend with us your voices.